Mr. Kalman Sultanic. I'm Leslie Fass in New York, New York, USA, in English. Today's May 16, 1996. We're speaking with Mr. Kalman Sultanic. I'm Leslie Fass in New York, New York, USA, in English. Mr. Sultanic, will you give us your full name?
Kalman Sultanic, K-A-L-M-A-N-S-U-L-T-A-N-I-K.
And your name at birth?
The 12th of April, 1917, in Mniechów, Poland.
And
M-I-E-C-H-O-W.
Did you have any other names?
No.
Or nicknames?
No.
And how old are you?
I am now 79.
And where were you raised?
In Poland, Mniechów.
And was that the town where you were raised?
Yes.
Would you describe it, please?
Well, Mniechów was a usual, ordinary, small town in Poland, a population of 10,000. It fluctuated 10,000, 12,000, 9,000. The Jews mainly constituted 40% of the population, which is 3,800 or 4,200. It was a very needed Jewish community. Because it was a small Jewish community, it was a needed Jewish community. The Jewish community was, I would say, the great majority was religious, not religious Orthodox Mizrahi, which is religious, but with much more Zionist education upbringing. And my family was a family, an Orthodox family. My father belonged to the Mizrahi, which is Orthodox Zionist. And they brought up the children with love, with affection. And we are a very needed family. And not only the family of the five children later, together we were five children. I was the oldest one. But also of the whole family lived in Mniechów or in the surrounding, the suburbs of Mniechów. So it was like the family got to meet each other, to be together Friday night, Saturday, because it was walking distance. And Saturday, Friday was a day where we were together, went to the synagogue, praying, Saturday morning to the synagogue, Saturday afternoon, the father, we went with friends to some walks. Mniechów was very surrounded by forests, by gardens, by a lot of fields. So we had where to walk, where to meet. The Jewish community lived apart. We were not part of the Gentile Jewish community. If we would have asked, or if you would have to describe the life in the town, you could say we and they. They lived separated, and we lived separate. And we, all our business, Jewish business and social life, were mostly concentrated around the Jews. Jews seldom did a Jew socially get involved or met with the Gentiles. Only maybe one or two, an exceptional Gentile. Neither the Jews nor the Gentiles were eager to socialize between themselves. So the Jews were separate and the Gentiles were separate. I would say intellectually and physically there was always tension between the Jewish community and the Gentile community. It was anti-Semitism. It wasn't anti-Semitism that we had pogroms every day, but here and there always were boycotts against the Jews, not to shop at the Jewish stores, not to go to the Jewish, if it was a Jewish doctor, not to go to the Jewish doctor, or something like that. It was always felt the tension between the Jews and the Gentiles. And this also transformed in the daily life for the children in the school. We had the school, the school which was for Jews and Gentiles, elementary schools. So we were together with the Gentiles. It was always the Jews were sitting separately. In the intermissions, there were always fights between the Jews and the Gentiles. But not fights like, sometimes they beat us up and we beat them up, but we always were fights and was tension between the Jews and the Gentiles. And this was also in the schools. But this was a half a day in the morning. In the afternoon, we had a double program. It was a Jewish school, a Jewish education. We went to the Jewish school and we learned till in the evening. In the evening, we did our homework till tomorrow. We were much happier, the youngsters, the youth, were much happier when we were in the Hebrew school. There we felt at home, among ourselves. In the school, when we were with them, we always, tension was there. What? This was always there. And this, but nevertheless, we were able to manage to live. And the Jews were, most of the 4,000 Jews were mainly in business, in commerce, also there were some professions, and it was, I would say, an upper middle class Jewish community. The Jews in Mierhof were very eager, the parents were very eager that the children will get a good education. I remember sometimes the father used to say, we are well off, but we are not very rich. But one thing what we want to give you a good education. This is the best investment what we can do. And this was, I would say, the whole pattern of the whole Jewish community, and I would say the whole pattern of the Polish Jewry. And it is true that Polish Jewry did much more Jewish education, Talmudic education, Bibles than the general education, but nevertheless, education. For example, my father was a religious man. He did not read Shakespeare. He did not read historical books, but he, every evening, if he had an hour or 2 hours, he studied the Bible. He studied the Bible just for the sake of studying, of more deeper and deeper to go to the Bible. And this was as part of his believing in God, believing in being an Orthodox Jew. And he tried to instill also in the children the same pattern, the same philosophy. Nevertheless, when the children were getting older, we became much more in the school, and the surrounding with the youngsters became Zionistic. And there were a few Jewish Zionist organizations in our town. I belonged to a youth movement, which was called Hashomer HaLumi, the other youth movement. This was a center youth movement, aiming to, when we get older, to go to a Hachshara, to a kibbutz in Poland, to be trained in a farm, and later maybe to get a permission to go to Israel and to live in Poland. Because we knew that in Poland there is anti-Semitism, we knew that there is no future for Jewry there, and especially for the youngsters. The father always said, I don't know whether I can go to Israel, or I can be move to Israel and become productive. But you children, if there is a chance, we will see to it that you should go to Israel. In 1934, uncle of mine, a brother of my mother, with his whole family, moved to Israel. As they called it as a special certificate, which was for the rich, which had. He could prove that he has £1 million, British pounds, and there he got permission for the whole family to go to Israel. I later met him when we came to Israel. We met him; they were still alive, which means that the majority of the people, if they would have a chance, unfortunately we didn't have a chance, would have gone either to Israel or to the United States because they felt Poland is not a secure place.
What was your father's name?
My father's name was Shmuel. We called him Shmuel. And my mother's name was Gittel, which is Samuel and Gittel. And he was very much involved in the Jewish community life, and whatever he could help people, he did help people, and he was involved whenever he could. Saturday was devoted to the family. Friday afternoon, Saturday was the family. This was a devoted, this was a time devotion for the family, synagogue, meals, talks, and being together with the family, either with our own family or meeting with the rest of the family in the wider circle.
Did you have siblings?
Did I have?
Brothers and sisters.
I had two brothers and two sisters. I was the oldest one. The two other brothers, the next to me was my sister Sarah, 2 years younger. My next to my other sister was my second sister, Ruja. She was 4 years younger than me. After that was my brother Sam, Shlamek. We called him Shlamek, but now we call him Sam. And the youngest one was Jacob. This was a family of five. And we used to meet all the time. Sunday, since Sunday was also a Gentile holiday, so most of the Jews who were active in Jewish life, the children went to school, to the Hebrew school on Sunday, had a full day of Hebrew school on Sunday. But the parents, my father was involved in all kinds of Jewish life, and the community, and the bank, and the social life, and the community, helping the poor, visiting sick people in the hospital, or whatever it is. This was the Sunday. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, half a day, was business. And this was the pattern of the life in the country. I went to school. I finished my school in the elementary school in Miechów, but since to go to a gymnasium, to high school, I was restricted because, first of all, there were limitations of a high school, of the gymnasium, which were a few hundred, maybe two, three Jews were accepted in the high school. So I went to a Hebrew school to Krakow, where I finished the Hilfstein Hebrew School in Krakow. And there where I went to school, and this was my education. I wanted to go to the university, but it was impossible to get an application. And I later worked as an assistant. I wanted always to be a lawyer, so I worked in my hometown. Was two Jewish lawyers. I got a job in a law firm, which I did secretarial work. An assistant, because the lawyer practically lived in Krakow and he most of the time spent in his hometown in Krakow. So I managed the whole office. It was only him and me. And I phoned to him whenever he needed to come to Miechów to appear in the court or to write an appeal. So we did it together. And I worked for 2 years with him in the law, and because I couldn't, and I always strive to get some kind of a way how to emigrate to Israel. And 2 years before the war, in 1937.
When you were how old?
Beg your pardon?
In 37? In
1937, which I was 22 years, I wanted to go to Israel, and this the requisite was that I had to go to a hachshara, to a farm. And I went to two kibbutzim, to Bistra, to a farm, and to Shechin, next to Bielsko, to a kibbutz, with the aim to get a certificate and to go to Israel. Unfortunately, I wasn't able, until I would have gotten the permission, the 39, the war broke out. And when the war, in 1939, when the war broke up, I found myself with my father and mother and our four other sisters and brothers in the home in Miechów.
Going back to your being reared in Miechów, could you describe a memorable Jewish holiday?
I could describe every holiday was memorable because it was not only to go to the shul. For us youngsters, it was Friday after the meal. My parents, we call them older people, but my parents met with the relatives, with other parents. and the children went out in the street, walked, got out of town, not out of town, but walked outside of the city, of the township, of the town, and they walked and discussed and singing songs, dancing, horas and other, but all with the aims of Israel, Zionism. And our Friday and Saturdays and the holidays, we were having discussions about Israel. We had always, everyone prepared some kind of, I was a leader of the youth movement in Merkhov, and I had to prepare some the meanings of the holidays to explain to the younger the meanings of Israel. We always tried to get information from the newspaper, from the bigger cities. I read the Hind, which was a newspaper which came from Warsaw, which was issued in Warsaw. Then I Novodiennik was issued in Krakow. And I got this newspaper to prepare myself to speak before the youngsters about Israel, about the Jewish situation in the world, and always got prepared myself to, as a leader to convey some information, important information pertaining to Israel and the situation of the Jews in the world. This found me in 1939, when the Germans attacked Poland the 1st of September. 6 days later, they came into already to Bierhof. And it is not only that when they came in, we knew already in 30, after 33, when Hitler already was elected democratically in Germany as Chancellor of Germany, we knew that bad times are for the Jews.
How did your parents perceive the rising of Nazism?
It was perceived by that my uncle with the family left for Israel. My parents were also thinking of going to Israel. At least they wanted very much to send the children away to Israel. But it wasn't simple and it wasn't easy. So, but we knew that this is that not good things are in store for us, and especially after 1933, because in Poland you had an organization, Gentile organizations, were called Endecja, which was the pro Hitler philosophy of Nazism, of Hitler against Jews, because the book Mein Kampf wasn't popular, wasn't there, but we knew that Hitler and his pronunciations and his declarations said that the Jews are the enemies of mankind and they have to be eliminated. And therefore we were very worried, and not only were we worried because of what Hitler in Germany, because the teaching of Nazism, and this has a great echo in Poland, where 10% of the population, of the Polish population, 35 million Poles and Jews, 3.5 million Jews lived in Poland. The greatest concentration of the Jews lived in Poland. And we knew that this is not going to be good, and especially after Hitler came to power, and the encouragement of the anti-Semitic organizations, they got encouragement, they got much more, they had and the police was acquiescing to the whatever they did, whether it was making boycotts against the Jewish stores or the Jewish profession, or sometimes in the synagogue or something other incident. The police was very mute, did not prevent, they did not encourage them, but we couldn't depend on the police 100%.
What was your father's business?
My father had a store, a hardware store, and we had also in forest business.
And was his business affected by the advent of?
Yeah, always, but it nevertheless, the Jews were always able, were competitive, and the Gentiles, in spite of the boycotts and others, they came to the Jews to shop in the Jewish shop, Jewish stores.
How did your family spend their summers?
The summers, most of the time, the parents spent, because Merkhov was not a big city, So we were surrounded by forests, and it was very pleasant to live there. But we youngsters, myself, every summer went to a colony, a Zionist colony for a month, or for 6, or for 8, or for 2 months away. And this is how I spent my summer teaching Zionism. We were taught Zionism, reading books, discussions, showed us films from the kibbutzim in Israel in that time, how Israel is going to establishing himself as a future state of Israel. So we were, I would say, Polish Jewry, 60-70% of Polish Jewry, maybe they were not organized Zionists, but they were philosophically Zionist-minded.
Do you have any special memories of family gatherings with grandparents or relatives?
Well, I remember only my grandparents, my mother and father of my mother, my grandparents from the mother's side. This I remember them. They lived in the same house, and they were very touching. My grandfather used to take me for a walk, used to tell me stories, used to read for me stories from the Bible, and I was his oldest grandchild, and I can now appreciate why he was so attached to me, because I know how I am attached. Maybe I shouldn't say it, but the first grandchild is always the most, you are more attached than I would say they are special attachment. And I remember my grandfather used to take me for walks, and the grandmother, and they used to come and to bring me some gifts, and to bring me a book, to bring me a toy, or whatever it is. I remember with affection the love of the grandparents of my mother, from the mother's side. From the father's side, I remember only my grandpa. My grandma already, I don't remember, she was not alive when I probably was 4 or 5 or 3 years. So I vaguely remember her, but really vaguely, I don't remember her. And he didn't live in the Mierhof. He lived in outside of Mierhof. It's like a 40 minutes walk from Mierhof, which I walked to him sometimes and visited him and stayed overnight. But I didn't have the close connections with him as I had with the grandparents from the mother's side.
And what were each of their names?
My issue of the name was Leib. And Reusel was the mother's, and Jakob was my father's name, father's father.
Could you describe the home you grew up in? What it looked like?
Well, my home was we had a very comfortable home. We were, I would say, upper middle class. We had 2 houses in Mierhof. One was of the outskirts of the city where we lived. But we had another house. We were planning to move to the city, in the center of the city, but we didn't. But because we were very comfortable in this apartment, we had 5 rooms with the 2 children. I mean, it's not a lot when you think the comparison in the United States, but when you think with the standards of living in Poland, this was considered a very, very comfortable house. And the fact is, when the Germans came in to Mierhof after they came in 1939, the 6th of September. Only a year later already, they created the ghetto. We had to move out from this comfortable house, from the five-room apartment house, and then we had to move in to leave everything, take very little with us belonging, and to move in an apartment with 5, 6 other families in 1 room, the whole 5. Which this was in 1941. And we had very little. 1942, they started already restrictions. The German already started with restrictions. For example, that we could not walk in the city till only from 9 till 4 afternoon. From 4 afternoon till 9 in the morning, we were not allowed to go out and to buy and to shop and to do our things and to walk in the city. This is one restriction. The other restrictions, we couldn't go out and do business. This is was restricted.
Were you bar mitzvahed?
Yes, I was bar mitzvahed. I prepared for the bar mitzvah. Usually, when you are bar mitzvahed, this is a great occasion because if it goes on, it is like a cycle. Because my old friends got bar mitzvah at the same time, 1-2 months, because we were in the same class, Hebrew class. And I was the oldest in the home, so they made a very big bar mitzvah. Everything happened at home. There was no catering, there were no restaurants, there were no hotels in our town, not a Jewish hotel. So the bar mitzvah was at home. The main ceremony was in the synagogue, and the main ceremony was in the synagogue, and the main ceremony was the crescendo, the importance of the great ceremony was the presentation of the speech of the bar mitzvah boy. So I remember that I had a special tutor. My father asked a special tutor to prepare me for the bar mitzvah, which I prepared for the bar mitzvah, first of all, to reading in the Torah, and to make a speech about the Parashat HaShavua, from the Parsha from the week. And I remember I made a speech, and I was very good, received very well. My parents, I'm sure, for them, this was a great moment, and this was one of the great occasions in the city, because everybody knew each other. And so, you know, Shmi's son has a bar mitzvah today. So first of all, everybody is invited to Kiddush in the shul. And later, everybody was expecting, everybody knew that I'm going to this synagogue, to this cheder, or to this school, and they knew my rabbi, and the rabbi had a high standing. They believed that I come with, and I'm sure will make a good, nice presentation, which I did.
Do you remember it?
Yes, I remember it, Parshat HaShavua, but I don't remember exactly what it was.
And what family members were there?
All the family members, not only the family, the close family members, the family members from the surrounding of the city came into the bar mitzvah and celebrated the bar mitzvah. And I also want to say that we had also other celebrations, like weddings, which was, if a wedding took place in Mirchhof, I would say 20% to every wedding, 20% of the 4,000 Jews were invited to the wedding. And it was an occasion from, like say, in the afternoon till 2-3 o'clock in the day after in the morning. It was dancing in klezmurim and speeches and all kind of recitations and that. It was a very high, and food, even though we were not, you cannot compare the food then to today's food, but nevertheless, it was very plenty. We enjoyed very much. We thought that we are the most.
Do you remember receiving anything special from your parents for your bar mitzvah?
I remember receiving a special Torah, which I received in a book, which I received, and it was for me a very dear thing, and I hold it on to a long time until, unfortunately, the Germans came and they asked us to move from the big apartment to the smaller apartment.
And do you remember what you wore?
No, I want to tell you one thing, that in such occasions you wear either a dark suit or a navy suit and a white shirt. And I would say later you will see how my father was dressed in the city. This was a religious, has a religious connotation, the same dressing I was dressed by when I was 13 at the bar mitzvah.
Thank you.
Okay, you recall that I finished when the time after my mitzvah, then when I came back and the Germans came into Mirchhof, and it was already, although we knew what can await us, and the war was not an unpredictable thing, because Hitler threatened to invade Poland, and then on the 1st of September, as I told before, he invaded Poland, and 6 days later he came to Mirchhof. And the ghetto life was unbearable. In the year 1940-41, there were restrictions. Restrictions, we couldn't go to the city. We couldn't buy, we couldn't talk, we couldn't meet. We had to be closed at the house from 4 o'clock to 9 o'clock in the morning. Valuables, the Germans announced that we should give in all the jewelry, all the furs, and those who will not obey the law will be killed. And they did some killing, some special to create fear and tension among the Jewish community. And one day was a very sad day for all of us. This day I will never forget, probably. It's one of the things which I will never forget. Then they asked all the Jewish community, I don't know whether it was at that time already 4,000, because it fluctuated. People left Mirhof to another place. They thought in another place they would be more secured. Or they ran away to Russia. They thought that in Russia would be more secured. Or something. It was the numbers of the Jewish community from 4,000 fluctuated more and less. So I don't know whether the old 4,000 and children that came out to the core of the Germans that we should come out. We came out, and they called up a name, Mr. Pinchowski, a friend of mine who was standing not far from me, and they called his name, and on the presence of everyone, seeing, looking, they shot him. When we started to find out what was the reason, they gave the reason, the Germans gave the reason, that he had a conversation with maybe a Gentile friend, or with a Gentile, or with someone, this is what they said. And he praised the Russians. And he said the Germans would lose the war. This was it. But I am sure that this is not true. I am sure that somebody properly said something, bad things about him, maybe, I don't know what. But anyhow, I know that he wasn't a communist, he wasn't a socialist, he was the same philosophical pattern as I. He was a Zionist, he didn't think of Russia, but nevertheless he was shot, and this already gave us to think that life is not going to be the same. We have to think of something, to do something.
And what was that year?
That fear was that if this could happen tomorrow, but to somebody else, and this could happen to not to one, to 10, to 15, to 20. And rumors also already started to circulate in 41. Circulate rumors that they are taking away Jews from different kind of ghettos, bringing them to labor camp. And there were also rumors, but not substantiated. There were already concentration camps in Treblinka, in Belzec, and other where they're bringing with cattle trains Jews from ghettos and killing them with gas. There were some rumors. But so we knew that it's not very good. At home, we started to think, what can be done? We knew that we are a family of seven. Everybody we couldn't do together with the whole family of 40 or 50, but the closest family of the seven at home, we started to think. We knew that we also had heard stories that women are very more in danger than men, because the women, they are not taking to labor camp, they are sending them away right away to gas chambers. So we were thinking of to find a place for our two sisters, that they should be able to be hidden by Gentiles, and maybe there is a chance they will survive. I remember we were talking at home, and we were starting to look Gentiles to friends to give them out and to try to save them. It wasn't easy to find someone. In the meantime, it came an order beginning of 1942 to send away 300 youngsters to a labor camp. Among the 300 youngsters from Mirhof, my two brothers were on the list, and they were sent away to Bonarka near Krakow, which later became amalgamated with a big camp of Plaszow, which I joined later, my two brothers. And they sent them away to Bonarka. Somebody used to go and visit someone. We had stories, and we knew that they are there, they are working every day. Conditions are bad, very meager food, and very restricted. Nevertheless, we knew that they are alive.
Could you describe the day you moved into the ghetto?
The
day when you moved, your family had to move into the ghetto. What was that like?
This was a day where everybody It was the order came 7 in the morning, 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning, and by 3 o'clock we had to be already from the 5-room apartment. We had to move in to this one room in the apartment of five families together. And we took very little. I remember my mother said, this we have to take. And my father said, this we have to take. My father took some books, Talmud books and other things. I wanted to take some memorable things. But we knew that we cannot, because we didn't have a car, or we didn't have a horse, or we didn't have a wagon. We had to carry. So how much can you carry to go to walk 10 minutes to the other place? So very little things, the things which were essential, everyone took with us, and we came in with strange people. Not we knew the people, but not people with family. It is by accident we were among the five families in these five rooms, and we had to adjust to seven. This was a terrible thing to live. The first night we didn't know how to sleep, where to sleep, and on what to sleep until we organized a little bed or something. But anyhow, it was a terrible thing, and we knew that this is not going to be good, that this is going to be a very great, that a great tragedy is awaiting all of the Jewish people and the Jews of Mirhof.
Were there guards?
Everything was done with the supervision of the Germans. Some posts, Deutsche, they call it a special. They were members of a special community. But nevertheless, it was supervised by the Germans, and fear was created that we should follow suit very, 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 very correctly. In the ghetto, you asked me this question, that my two brothers went to Bonarka, and this was in 42. And we knew that we received information from that here and there. Nevertheless, we knew that this is not going to be good, and that the end is coming of the ghetto, and we are going to be taken out someday, because we heard that ghettos in the surrounding places of Mirhof are being liquidated. So we finally my father said, we have to do something for my two daughters, for your two sisters. I went out and find a place by the Gentiles to hide them. I remember I took them off the ghetto, I arranged with the guards, that they should be allowed to get out of the ghetto. The Gentiles waited for them also in the evening. They took them away, and they went to the ghetto. We gave them more or less the best thing what we could have, the valuable thing, because we had to pay for holding them there. But unfortunately, we didn't know when the ghetto would be liquidated. Two days later, I received information. Somebody came in and said, your two sisters are outside the ghetto. You have to come out and pick them up. The Gentiles brought them back. They were scared to hold them, and they have to. I don't blame the Gentiles, because I was very grateful in the first place when they decided to take them and to hide them. It was a relief for my parents and for myself that at least the two sisters, hopefully, maybe, if the war will be finished quickly, they will survive. Because we did not believe, we already had doubts whether we will survive at that time, in 1942. Because we heard all kinds of rumors. And therefore,
rumors like what?
Rumors that concentration camps, gassing, and bringing on cattle, liquidating ghettos, and with gas, and killing out, shooting. And so we heard the rumors. We couldn't put our fingers that this happened, and we didn't have information about that, because this was still, but the Germans kept it a secret. I will later say, when I talk about philosophy, I will mention this. The Germans said that Himmler in 1942 said the greatest secret, the greatest thing that the Germans were doing, he spoke to the in Posen in 1942 to the officers. He said, the greatest thing the Germans will do will be remembered in history as the killing of the Jews. But this has to remain a secret. This has to remain a secret. Every one of you has to give me a swear that they will not reveal this secret. Which means that it was a very ambivalent statement because they knew that if they will lose the war, that this, they will have to pay a price for that. Everything was kept a secret what they are doing with the Jews. They always said they are taking us to labor camp, to bring us to the east in a labor camp, to work and to do some things for the soldiers which are on the front. This was their explanation. But we knew that this is not the truth, this is not the real story. And therefore we tried to hide these two sisters, but it did not happen. 2 days later, after the two sisters came back to our home, to the ghetto, Friday morning, September 3rd, they surrounded the ghetto.
Who did?
The Germans. And they said, everybody has to come out and bring whatever he can, whatever he is, very small things, and to come out from the home. Well, my father and my mother and my two brothers were already, as I told you before, they were already in the Bonarka, in the labor camp, but we five came out. My father, before coming out, said, whatever it has happened, let us divide. We don't know whether we will go together, we will be together. Let us divide the valuable things among all the five. So he divided whatever the father did, he decided to do, to give everyone a piece of gold, a piece of some valuable things. And we went and marched to the train station. It was a march, I would say, 15 minutes march, with Germans, with dogs around us, rabbi of the city. And I saw in the middle of our walk, my father went over to the rabbi and he shook his hands. And it came to my mind at that time, Tzarat Rabim Chatzi Nechama. The consolation, the tragedy of many is a half consolation. I'm sure that seeing that the rabbi too and friends and everybody is going to the same destiny was a little consolation. And maybe my father said, maybe my two sons, which are already in camp, maybe this camp will be safe. I mean, I'm sure what went through his mind. And when we came to this place at the train, the Germans tried to segregate right away women and children on one side, men on the other side. Later they segregated the old men. My father was 52, 53, so they didn't know. He looked on the face, he looked still tall, skinny, not very skinny, but very fit. So they asked him to show his hand, whether he would be able to to walk in a labor camp. He showed his hand, he said, okay, you can remain here on this side. And he remained with me. In the meantime, my mother, and the two sisters were on the other side. My father has second thought. And he talked to me. He said, look, I know what I'm going to tell you is, and I wanted you should listen to me. I cannot let my mother, my wife, and my two daughters go alone. I have to join them. You, it looks to me, will go and join my two brothers, and all three of you will maybe help each other to survive. And don't follow me. You stay here. I'm going to go on the other side. And he just like pushed me gently with his hand, and he went on the other side. And this separation took another hour, probably. And after I looked at them, they looked at me, and other families which were there. And finally, I saw he called me, and he collected all the valuable things which he divided, his mother's, and the two sisters, and threw it on the other side to me, with a innuendo or message, you will need them. For us, it looks to me, he said, he meant is not going to be of any use.
He said that?
He didn't say it, but this was the message. It was clear. Why should he collect the valuables and give it to me and for him and for them not to live anything? It makes sense. I had a very difficult time because I thought to myself, why, suppose my father is right and I will have a better chance to live than they. Do I have a right to do that? And it came to my mind stories of consolation that my father said, we have to find that you should go to Israel because things are very bad and in Israel you will be saved. I think that in this moment when I thought maybe to go over to my father and to my mother and my two sisters to join them too, this was my thought, maybe I should stay here because my father would be more consoled, more happy if I remain there. And when he will travel in the train, the cattle train, on his way to the last minute to his death, he will think, maybe I remained, and together with my two brothers, maybe they will remain, and they will remember, and they will tell the story what happened to us. And of course, I did not of course, but and I meditating and thinking, and I remained there, and I at night they separated, they took us on that other train, and I, in the morning I was there when my two brothers, a whole night, it's an hour, 2 hours, a train ride, but it took us a whole night, took us in cattle trains, and brought us over to Plaszów, where my two brothers were already there, and I joined them, and we were together in Plaszów. And this was really I will never forget the moment when my father said, I cannot let my wife and my two daughters go alone, stay alone, and I should remain on this side with you. You will join your brother, and you will help each other to survive. I have to my place, my time, and this is, I think, if heroism is not only when you can take a gun and shoot somebody. It's easier to do that than to do what my father did. Because this takes a long time of thinking. This is meditating. This is philosophically brought him back. I would say that his action, for me, it was unique, but it was not unique. Because this was the upbringing of the Jewish family. This was the philosophy of the Jewish closeness and the respect for the family and the honor of the family to help each other, to be together, and not to let somebody go away alone and if he's to think maybe I can help and to let him alone. This is why I think this moment of heroism which my father has done is will remain as a guiding light, has remained as a guiding light in my own life, in my family life, in my social life, in my life which I am working as a volunteer in many organizations, to be devoted to a cause. And heroism is not only to take a gun and to go and shoot or to fight with a knife, but a heroism is also the holiness of a family and the sacred of a family and the respect of a family.
Did your mother seem to have the same awareness your father had?
Maybe, I'm sure she had the same awareness, but it did not come to the expression as it came to my father, because my mother was there with my two sisters. But I am sure, 100%, if this would happen differently, she would definitely do the same thing as my father did.
Did she seem nervous when she was standing out of line?
Well, you couldn't judge whether she was nervous or not, everyone was mute, everyone was resigned, everyone was thinking that this is the end of the world comes to an end, and all the stories that they are taking us to the labor camp, it's not true, why should they separate the young and those who are able to work, separate on a different train, and why should they take the old and the wives and the women, children, and old on the other side. It was very clear, a clear message. Even the Germans could not hide this. with their action. This is more than words. This is more than pronouncement. This was a clear pronouncement that those who are going on the other side are going to the death camp. And we, when I was there, some people from Yehov hired a woman, a Gentile woman, to follow, to see whether she can follow the train which left Mirchow, exactly where the train left and what happened to the people which were on the train. I did not speak to the woman, neither did I hire this woman, but I heard the story that she came back and said that the train, which was correct, that the truck, it took them a few days, and the truck and the trains came to Belzec, and they came in, went in, and nobody came out. And so this was the answer of that. So we knew that this is the end of the parents, and this is a period that my camp, which was issued in 1925 by Hitler, which he was a nobody, and he was a marginal man which didn't have any influence in Germany, that when he wrote the Mein Kampf, when he said that he wants to liquidate the Jews, he meant it, and he is going to implement that. And after that, when he said that he organized to give the first signal, the Kristallnacht, and taste the Germans' behavior towards the Jews, and which he did. And the behavior was, of course, the Germans were very eager to kill, to vandalize Jewish property, to kill and to vandalize and to do whatever it is to frighten the Jews. He got an answer from the Germans: "We are ready to follow your suit." And therefore, we knew that time. And in the camp, my brother and I. The Jews knew that this is now the end of us, and we have to see what we can do to save ourselves.
Do you remember your arrival at Plaszow?
Yes, I remember I arrived in Plaszow in the middle of the night, early in the morning, in the middle of like 4 or 5 o'clock, it was dark still. And the Germans, some of the Ukrainians which worked for the Germans, picked up because they knew that we have somebody has watches and somebody has something else. So they took us, everybody out, and they didn't pick me, but they picked others and took away the watches to the, and hit. And that at night, it was again creating terror and to scare us and to be in tension and that we should be afraid all the time. And this was following all the time. And in the first day of the camp, I remember the appel in the morning, the day that we arrived, everybody got a number, not a name, a number. There were numbers which were stick to the people which still they have, which you couldn't erase, because the numbers were they're kind of chemical. But our numbers, after a few years, disappeared. My number, but I had a number, and we were not known as names anymore. We were known by number.
You were tattooed.
I had a tattoo, a number, and they called the numbers, and then often we tried. I manipulated that way that I was not far from my brother in the barrack, and we were almost all the three of us very close to each other, and we tried to be together all the time as much as we could. Besides, and also to work together. But it was such a terror that it was impossible to hold on to it. It was impossible to survive. We believe that it's impossible to survive. One, the youngest brother said, he gave in, he cannot take it anymore. He is running away. So we tried to tell him that he should not run away, where would he run? He said he heard that in Sosnowitz, as a ghetto, they are not liquidating yet, and that, and they are going to that. And anyhow, he ran away. So we had again, I brought back the few valuable things, we had it all together. We gave him most of the things, because we in the concentration camp, we could buy a potato maybe with a piece of gold or a piece of bread, But we felt that he should have it more. Maybe he will be able to use it while he is running away and going until he will come to this ghetto where he will be able to survive. On his way to the Sosnovyets, he was caught on a train, and he was sent to Auschwitz, and later he was sent to Dachau. We survived in Dachau. We didn't know, but later I will come back to that. We, both of us, remained in Plaszów. In 1943 in Plaszów. But let me describe you a day in the camp.
And who was the leader?
The leader was Gett, the terrible man, he was famous for shooting and for walking with dogs. And he took people to walk for him and around his villa, in his garden, or in his road, or in his pavements to fix it. We knew that 30 people, he always asked for 30 or 40 people. Everybody avoided to go to this, to be in this group, to go to walk for him. Because we knew that either one or two is going to be shot by him directly, or he will let the dog kill one or two men. And this was the daily operation. The morning, 6 o'clock, was the appel. The appel, no day passed when the appel took place that one or two people should not, sometimes more, but one or two people should not be called out by the numbers and killed. Sometimes also, this was not the daily happening, but sometimes also the dogs were killing the Jews. Well, this was special. The excuses was always that people, they counted that some run away, and this is why we are killing you, which is not true. But just they had always explanation, and to create fear, and to create tension and fear, that we should know not to run away, because they were not so much, they knew that it's very difficult to run away, but they are very afraid, because I believe their notion that they didn't want that the truth should come out, what they are doing with the Jews. So this was, I believe, one of the things why they always said, we are killing you, we are shooting, we are killing you with dog, because you are not good, you are not behaving, you are running away, and this is why we are. Well, one day I remember they selected my brother, me, among the 30 people to go and to build a road, a piece of road to fix it and to build it. And it was always when you had 30 or 40 people, one was a supervisor, a Jew. And after that, after we were supposed to finish after 4 days, the supervisor, we thought that we did a good job. We always tried to do, because we knew that it's not a joke. And the German said, I don't like your job. All of the 30s which you are, I'm going to tell and shoot. He, in the beginning, said, sir, we tried to convince him, look, you know that we working, this is not our first job. Previous jobs, and we told them how we did always conscientiously fulfill our work very to the last minute. Why should we do that? Anyhow, I don't know how it happened. He took only the couple, the head of the group, with another 30 people on before everyone, took them on a truck and shoot all of the 30 together with the 30. And we're safe for this day. We didn't know what is going to happen tomorrow.
We're going to pause now. Kalman Sultanic.
Okay, you know that we were in Plaszów and the situation was unbearable. And we looked for some kind of solutions to register, to go to work. When we listened that they always try to announce that there is a registration to go to a factory to work, to another place. We were always skeptical. But one day they announced that they are going to create a factory. There is a factory very close to Plaszów. And if whoever wants to go to work to this factory should register. I'm sure that the registration was a few thousand, and my brother and myself registered to this factory. And this was 1943, middle of the year, 1943. And we, on day, they announced 1,200 people who were taken to a factory, and the supervisor was Schindler. In the factory, we produced parts, mostly parts for the army, for and all kind of chairs and tables, all kind of things in this factory. We worked, but right away we arrived in this factory, we saw a difference, that it's not Plaszów as we used to. There is no terror, there's no shooting, there is no dogs killing, a different atmosphere. We walked, and the walk was very, not, I would say, it was bearable. And also, in addition to that, we started to see this Schindler coming, not every day, but once in a while Schindler used to come, especially at times when the Germans visited the camps to see in this factory, to see whether we are working, you know, how our work is. He always was there, because he knew that the Germans are going to try to shoot somebody or to take somebody, killing or something like that. He, I would say in a short sentence, he tried to protect us. What is happening in Plaszów upstairs, we call it upstairs, should not happen in Plaszów, in the factory under the jurisdiction of Schindler. And in addition to that he protected us, and it was no shootings, and it was no fear, and it was much, much calmer. He, every Sunday morning, came a truck with bread. In addition to that, to the ration, what we got every morning, a piece of bread with a coffee or a soup, we got a loaf of bread. Everyone got a loaf of bread for 1 week in addition to that. This was something unbelievable for us. And this was a great relief. Between seven and eight months, we were there in this factory, and we were really safe and protected by Schindler. And I really think that the Jews after the war, that we made him a righteous Gentile, and he was buried in Israel. He deserves it, and we should be very grateful for him. And the film, Schindler's List, really transformed the way Schindler truly behaved in to protect the Jews which work in this factory. And later, the one which was a list made and took them to Czechoslovakia, and he saved them in Czechoslovakia. And he deserves it. And I think whatever all the things what we did for him, he really, truly deserves it. And after that, after 7-8 months, this factory was liquidated because the things which we produced was not necessary properly, and we were all brought back to the Plaszów, back to this camp. In the meantime, we didn't know, my brother and I didn't know, that somebody is preparing, Schindler with a group of some Jews are preparing a list, which is close to Schindler, of 1,100 people, to go to Czechoslovakia, to another factory with Schindler, and take them away. My brother and myself were not included in this list. Not everyone which was working downstairs with Schindler was included. Maybe 50%, maybe 30%, I don't know. I couldn't tell you, because a lot of other people went to this Schindler's, to Czechoslovakia. One of my best friends from the camp, from Plaszów, which is basically from not far away from my hometown, a friend before the war, which is now I was a member of the Supreme Court in Israel, was in this camp in Czechoslovakia, and he confirms that after Plaszów in Czechoslovakia, Schindler behaved the same, protecting them from the Germans. So we were back in Plaszów, and again it was terrible again. One day, another announcement came that they are registering people to a tank to build tanks in a factory to build tanks. And they need mechanics. So we said we are mechanics, my brother and myself. And we, myself, and we registered on this list, and we were taken to Dresden by train, by cattle trains, 500, 600 people. And we came to a big factory of tanks. We were, it wasn't only Jews, but it was non-Jews too there, Russians and others. Next to me was a Russian, and he was very nice. He brought me, he was a supervisor, and he had more food than we got, and he used to bring me a potato at night to my brother. He was very friendly. He was closer to my brother. He worked, he supervised my brother. He brought my brother sometimes a potato, sometimes a piece of bread extra. And this was a great help. Till March 1945, you understand, was a great bombardment in Dresden. Great bombardment in Dresden, and where 150, 160,000 people were killed. The West bombarded Dresden, and we, our factory too, and we were one, middle of the night, were running away from the barracks. We were on the street, and the Germans, again, they didn't give up. They took us, and they started to march us to the east, further to the east, away from Dresden. On our march, it was very. If Plaszów was even considered relatively better than what happened on the march, what the Germans did is, they didn't know what to do with the people which are in the camps. Some of the crematoriums stopped to work. Some of the crematoriums already were, the places where the crematoriums were in existence, were occupied by the Russians. So here they have, at that time, which I later we found out, were 50, 60,000 Jews on the march, on the death march. The death march was really, the Germans didn't have, were not organized, were disorganized, there were no food, there were no water, and even the Germans didn't have enough, whatever they had, but this is not the issue. We had to walk every day, cold, and this was March, April, which was very cold at that time, and we were, and those who were weak, and those who couldn't walk were shot right away. I would say 10-15% or 20% from the 60,000 which marched, which were on the dead march, were killed while marching till the Germans were overthrown and the Russians took over. 20 or 30% Jews were killed. And this march was a terrible thing which to go through and to survive. I was my brother was stronger than me. He helped me. And he always said, we will survive, don't give in. And he sometimes used to help me, and sometimes even used to give away a piece of bread and said, you need it more than I do. And anyhow, we one day at night, we saw that the German is going and coming and said, so I got some courage. I spoke a little German, I had 2 years in school German, so I asked him, could you tell me where are we going? What is our destiny? Because he already wasn't as the normal German which was shooting and shouting. That was different already. They knew already that their end is also coming, that the Russians are close. So he said, we are looking for crematoriums how to gas you. But for us, it's unfortunately, we cannot find. And for you, it's fortunate. He didn't say it, but this is what he meant. And a few days later, the march door, it lasted, I think, between 22 and 25 days, until we arrived in Theresienstadt. In Theresienstadt, we were a few weeks, the Germans, but it was really chaos. The Germans were every day, somebody else, a German was there, wasn't here, wasn't there, food was not coming, even the water, the ration of the piece of bread didn't come. One night, we got up in the morning, and in May, and beginning of May, and the Germans were gone, and the Russians took over. A lot of people died after that, because everybody was, the Russians gave us food, some people couldn't already digest the food, and the food which they gave us, it's not that they didn't want to give us good food, but they didn't have whatever we needed at that time, but some people died, and it was already, the Russians behaved very well towards us, and some in Theresienstadt, there were already nurses coming and helping us, and it was already organized also some help for us, and we were already, everybody was on his own. We decided to go back and try to go back everybody to his home. We decided to go to Prague. They said that in Prague is a big concentration of survivors which are coming out of the camps, and in Prague you can get food, you can get clothes, you can get doctor's help, nurse's help, so we, and also medications. So we went to by train to Prague. In Prague there was a very big organization in Prague organized for the survivors, those who came out of the camp. They gave us some money to go by train and to go to buy ourselves something, and also food. He gave us some marks, some permission to buy food and to eat in restaurants. And we stayed in hotels. They gave us also clothes to change. And it was already a very different environment after that. And we knew that we survived. Whatever it is, we know that the war is at the end. The Germans were defeated. The Americans and the Russians won the war, and therefore it is a different time also for us.
Can you describe how you felt the first few hours of liberation?
First few hours were unbelievable. We knew that it's coming. We knew that it's coming because we heard already stories coming. Even the Germans already gave us to understand that it's coming. But nevertheless, we didn't believe. When this happened, when we got up in the morning, and we saw a change. Instead of the Germans, we saw the Russians. There, we knew that something great, unexpectable happened to us. When we were both of us in Prague, we decided to go back to our hometown and to see whether maybe our brother, which ran away, maybe is alive, maybe some from our family, which maybe went out hiding, maybe he came back. We went to Mierhof. I met my cousin, Ruzsa, which was my mother's brother's daughter, came back from Auschwitz in Mierhof. And also we met an uncle, Bergo, which came back from hiding. We met him in Mierhof. We stayed in Mierhof together, the Jews stayed a few days, to wait whether somebody is coming. We tried to find out what is the situation with my brother, with my younger brother, whether he's alive, survived or not. We couldn't find out anything. And we, both of us, decided to go away. Yes, and one day my cousin said that he's going away. My uncle said that he's going away, Aaron Bergo, going away to get back his valuable things from some of the Poles, from other Poles he was hidden, and he survived to get back his valuable thing. Later, a day later, he didn't come back. We started to find out questions. He was killed by the other Poles. This was a great blow, and I said to my brother, I think it's dangerous. We have to go away from Mierhof. Here they know us, and they will come after us, and they might kill us. Let us go away. We went first to Krakow, and we found out, and later to Sosnowiec, we found out that my brother, Jakub, survived in Dachau, and he is in Munich with another group of survivors, and lives, we got his address where he is. And since I became very active in the Zionist movement at that time, to organize, to help youngsters to organize on their way to Israel, the way to go to Germany, to Italy, to Vienna, to the camps, and to register to go to Israel. I said, I will remain here because I am still active and I cannot go away. I cannot, I'm part of this organization, and became very active and became one of the leaders of the movement, of the Ichud movement in Poland. I became of the member of the Central Committee of the Ichud movement in Poland. And I was, and I said, I will come later on to Munich. I got the responsibility to organize a kibbutz in Kelce as part of youngsters, which Kelce is not far from Yehuv. And I organized a kibbutz. Youngsters were coming to be there and on the way to later to go on a trip to Germany or to Italy and on the way to Israel. I was responsible and I was active in Kelce. I was active also to organize other kibbutzim. I was part of the movement. And after I finished, I have a book which has now came out in Israel, which are giving me credit in the book for my organizing this kibbutz, for helping organize this kibbutz, even though I left afterwards for another place to be responsible in Katowice for all of Katowice and other kibbutzim and Bittom and in Gleiwitz. But I left Katowice, and later, a few weeks later, after I left Katowice, this in the 4th of July was a great tragedy in Kelce, where the pogrom took place in the middle of the day. They spread a rumor that the Jews are hiding a Gentile child and instigated a pogrom and killed 43 Jews in Kelce. Two of the members of the kibbutz which stayed behind of the group which didn't live for the trip to Germany and to Israel were also killed among the 43. There was investigation and was all kind of that. There was a quick, the Poles later said that NKVD, the Russians, instigated the whole thing, and it's their fault. The Russians said it's not true, the Poles did it, and I'm sure that the fact is that the Poles killed them. This is a fact. It's not only the 43 were killed. During 1945 and 46, after the liberation, 1,500 Jews were killed in different places by the Poles.
And what year was this?
This was 45. In July 45. No, July 46. It's 50 years now, which is going to be in July now, the 50-year commemoration of the Kelce pogrom. It's July 1946. In 1945, after the liberation, till 1946, 1,500 Jews were killed on different places, on different occasions, in Poland, by Poles, on different occasions. I was then responsible for other kibbutzim, in Katowice, in Bittom, and Gleiwitz. And then I was head of this region, on behalf of the Zionists, of the Ichud movement. And I needed a secretary which knew Hebrew, and I interviewed, and my wife was in the kibbutz in Gleiwitz on one of my trips Friday night when I delivered a speech about Shabbat and about Israel. I met my wife, and she knew Hebrew because she went to a Hebrew gymnasium in Kovno. You will later find out that from her. And I asked her whether she would like to be my secretary. This was in 1946. And in 1947, we married in Germany. And from there, we went to Germany. I married her. We married. We had to find out. We had two sons and And we have five grandchildren, and we I stayed behind in Poland till 1940, end of 1946. In beginning 1946. From there, I went to on my way to Prague. From Prague, we went together with my wife to Vienna. I got I practically ran away from Poland, because what happened is that they the NKVD, the Polish police, and together with the Russian police, the Aliyah was not official. They was not permitted. And this was illegal, done by us illegal. They caught a group of 40, 50 people, and they asked him, who gave you the, we gave them false papers to travel, and they said, they gave my name. And they gave my name, I didn't know that, and they came to arrest me. But I was already on the way to leave Katowice, and they arrested somebody else, a shaliach from Israel. And this shaliach wrote letters to me that I should come, because nothing will happen to me, but I understood that this was, that's not true, that they are forcing him to write these letters. And the same night, I left Katowice for Prague, and from Prague I left for Vienna, and from Vienna, both of us, with my wife, arrived in Munich. And I met my two brothers in Munich, in 46, I had my two brothers, and met them, and I saw my brother was very sick, the younger one was very sick, tuberculosis. I tried to take care of him as an older brother. My brother also took care of him. We sent him away to a special place where he was cured in a way, a little bit cured, but later was cured entirely. And he later studied dentistry to become a dentist. And I was become very active in the Zionist movement again in Germany. I was elected to the Central Committee of the Liberated Jews. In Germany of the American zone, you had 140,000 Jews in different camps, Feldfing, Landsberg, and other camps, where the Zionists were very active in organizing the youngsters to go to Israel. I became very active, and in 1946 were elections to the Zionist Congress, to the 22nd Zionist Congress, which is the first Zionist Congress after the Second World War. And I was elected by democratic elections as a delegate to the Congress, to the Zionist Congress, together with other 11 delegates. And I went to Basel, which I met very distinguished leaders from Israel, from the whole world. And I became very active, and was elected again to the Central Committee of the General Zionists in Basel. And that time we organized the World Confederation of United Zionists. The president became Dr. Israel Goldstein, a very famous rabbi of Bnei Jeshurun in America. And he offered me to be his come to the United States and work with him as his assistant, which I accepted. But he said it might take a few years, because he has to go to Israel and to become the treasury of the Jewish agency. The state of Israel was not in existence at that time. It was only the Jewish agency, which was a quasi-government in Israel. But it was not a government of Israel, because the state of Israel came into being in 1948. So this was not he became the treasury of the Jewish agency, and he came to Israel. I worked with him in Israel, and then he went back to the United States, and then I went to the United States. When he offered me the job, I accepted. I came back to Germany, got married with my wife. My wife had a very cousin, a very famous biologist in the Hebrew University, and she got in touch, she was in touch with him, so friends who came to visit her, this was her first cousin, and he said that she should come to Israel, and he will enable her to study, she wanted to study in the university. And she decided, even though we were married, she understood that I cannot go away, because I was just elected to the Central Committee of the Liberated Jews, and I had a portfolio, and I had to stay in Munich. But she decided to go to Israel, and to, because of her desire to continue her studies in the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. She came to Jerusalem, and when she started to study, right a few weeks later, the war broke out, and she interrupted her studies. And this was 47, till 48, she was alone. In Germany, I was, again, as I told you, was active, and in 47, there was a general Zionist council taking place in Zurich, which Ben-Gurion came that time, and he asked a few leaders from Germany, Zionist leaders, to come to Zurich. I came to Zurich in 1947 with a few others, and he explained to us and told us that he wants to organize the Exodus, this famous ship, and we should be responsible for the organizing of the Exodus, and from the German point of view, to take trucks to bring the people to the boat, to Lübeck, and to send them to on the Exodus and to Israel. Ben-Gurion told us that time he is interested not only that Exodus should be on the waters on the way to Israel, because he knew that in 1947 a United Nations commission will come to interview the survivors in the camps in Germany and on the British zone and ask them where their desire is to go, whether they want to go back to their hometown, where they lived before, whether they want to go to the United States, or they want to go to Israel. He said, I wanted you should organize that when the delegation with the interview come from the United Nations, interviewing these people, where they want to go, that there should be a great majority of those survivors should talk very clearly, very vividly, that their way, that they don't want to go neither back to Poland, not to Romania, not to Hungary, not to Czechoslovakia, and not to the United States. A few want to go to the United States, but they want to go to Israel. He wanted to exert political pressure on the United Nations before they will make the decision of the establishing of the State of Israel. And we went back, he said, I came only to meet with you, because this is a very important thing. And I left Israel, and I didn't have even time to leave Israel for this meeting, which is taking place here. I came only to meet with you because I want that you should help organize the Exodus and also the public opinion and among the survivors, that they should express a clearly statement, send back a clear statement that they want to go to Israel and not to return to their home, not somewhere else.
And you did?
And we did. We came back and we worked very hard and we accomplished both. When they came, I was also interviewed by the representative from Belgium, and I gave him a speech, of course, that the Jews don't want to go back to Poland, they have no confidence to Poland, they want to go to Israel. I said to him, had Israel be in existence before the creation of the state, before the Holocaust would not have happened.
We're going to pause now.
Okay. Okay, as I mentioned to you, I came back to Germany, and we were very successful both in the organizing the Exodus and in public relation to speak to the 140,000 Jews on the United States zone, U.S. zone, to convince them to, when they will be interviewed, to say that they want to go to Israel, and they did it, and it was very impressive. And the fact is that the committee, which came on behalf of the United Nations, brought back a message that the great majority of the Jews in the camps in West Germany and on the British zone and on the French zone, which was a smaller group of Jews, the great majority wants to go to Israel and not to any other place, especially not to return to their original places where they were born and taken away to the concentration camps. After that, we were active again in organizing the boat and the camps. I was a member of the Central Committee. And in 1948, I decided I want to join my wife in Israel. She was already in Israel. And it was a war. And I said, it's not fair that I should be in Germany and she should be alone in Israel with the family. She stayed with her family. She couldn't continue study because the university was closed. So in 48, and beginning of April, 48, I went by boat to Israel. It was still the war, and I was picked up by my friends and brought to, and I went to my wife. My wife was in a place called Karkur, near Haifa, near Pardes Hanna, near Hedera, near Tel Aviv, and I stayed a few days, and I got in touch with a Zionist organization, with whom I were connected. The same way as I started after the war to get to be connected again with the organization which I was connected before the war, I was connected now after the war, and now I got in Israel. It was very simple because it was a very strong organization which I got in touch with. And I also got in touch with Dr. Israel Goldstein, who I met in Basel, and he was there already back in Israel, working as treasurer of the Jewish agency. And I became the secretary general of a constructive fund called Hakem, and the Welcome Federation of United General Zionists. And I was very comfortable with my job. And we, in 1949, the 10th of the 20th of October, no, the 10th of October, 49, my wife gave birth to my first son, Aaron. And again, it was a very great thing for us, that we are building a family, we are sick, back normal, like normal people. In Israel, I was my wife, we used to go to visit families, and we used to work. And I also decided that in spite of being busy and active in the Zionist movement and in having my job, I wanted to continue to study. And I had my examination to the University of Law School of Economics in Tel Aviv University, and I was accepted at night, to study at night. And I studied for a year and a half. I didn't finish. I didn't finish in the United States. I studied also in Columbia University, Law Economics, and I didn't finish. But later I will come to that because I gave up economics and I switched to law, and I registered because I couldn't meet the schedule. Because I was very active, my job required that I should travel a lot, and I couldn't attend the courses at night. So I looked for an open university where I can, through correspondence, finish my studies. So it was, I registered to La Salle University in Chicago when I came back, and I finished the La Salle University, and I made the test at New York University, and I got my degree in law. I never practiced by law. But in Israel, I was very active in attending meetings. My wife was not very happy because I was not very much devoted to the family because of being active in the Zionist and in my job. But I said, I made up my mind that this is a transition period, because of my commitment, when Dr. Israel Goldstein will move back to the United States, I will also move with my family to the United States. And in 1951, we moved to the United States, and with the family. First I came alone, later my family joined me with my son Aaron, and we lived first in a hotel on 81st Street, Columbia Hotel. And later we had an apartment, and I was working as a director, as general secretary with Dr. Goldstein and his assistant, being the General Secretary of the World Confederation of General Zionists, which is again required for me a lot of work and a lot of travel. I traveled a lot, and I was able to accomplish. I was always re-elected to my job, because my job was not only a professional job, but also as a volunteer, an elected job, and I was always re-elected as a director general, and I was very happy with my achievements, and also with the family life. In 1994, in 1954, my second son Samuel was born in New York, and we had already our family, a bigger family, and my two brothers, who were lived with us in New York, but later they decided they had business, because they were American citizens. But later they had also some camera connection business, the two brothers with Germany, and they traveled back and forth. Later they stayed more time in Germany than in the United States. Of course I objected to that, but you know, business is business, and they settled in Germany. As American citizens, they came to the United States every year for a few months to stay with us, with other member of family in a hotel, but they settled practically in Germany. And I was working very happily in my job as a Zionist, traveling around the world and accomplishing many, many things in the direction of leadership in the Zionist movement.
Were your children named after anyone?
My first son was named after Aaron, after my wife's brother, who was killed. This, you will hear the story later from her, by the Lithuanians before the Germans came in. He was named after them. And my second son, Sam Shmuel, was named after my father. My grandchildren already have names of my mother and my different families and my wife's families, but my father's name was carried on by my second son, Samuel. In the United States, I was very active not only in the Zionist movement, but also I became very active in the Holocaust and anti-Semitism. I believe that and I wanted to devote my time besides of my job to the awareness of the world and of the Jews, what happened to the Jews in Eastern Europe and during the Holocaust. Let me bring in some thought. Now in the middle also, I will come back to other things, but let me bring in some thoughts about the Holocaust. The Holocaust is unique. Why is the Holocaust unique? Because the Jews were not at war with Germany. The Jews did not create a threat to the German army and to the German people. They were spread, they didn't have arms. This is just was a philosophy of annihilation of the whole Jewish people, and he meant it. It is true that the Holocaust did not happen in a vacuum, because we know that anti-Semitism was very active, was very in existence in all Eastern European countries and Central Europe, where 90% of the Jewish people, of the Jewish population, resided. And therefore, Hitler, when he pronounced the annihilation of the Jews, when you see what he did, you can really be convinced that this was ideologically and philosophically. And he had the cooperation of some of the people of the countries in Eastern Europe. Because the people of Europe were anti-Semitic. The anti-Semitism came, really, the cradle of anti-Semitism stems from the church. The church in Eastern Europe, in Central Europe, taught that the Jews killed Jesus. And therefore, the Jews are not normal people. The Jews are the enemies of humankind. And therefore, they have to be annihilated. And therefore, it was easy for him to bring this message to the Eastern European people. But one has to make a distinction between a pogrom, which used to take place in Eastern Europe, in some countries, and the Holocaust. The Holocaust, the responsibility for the Holocaust, lays solely, entirely with the German people, with the Nazis, with Hitler. They did it, they pronounced it, they created, they structured it, they did it by themselves, they did it, they were helpers. But they did it, but they should be responsible and for the Holocaust. We have to say another thing, that in end of 1942, Hitler already saw that he is going to be defeated. Hitler saw that the Eastern Front is the minute he couldn't break through the Eastern Front in Leningrad and Stalingrad, he saw that he needs more manpower, more soldiers. And what did he do? The Wannsee Conference, which took place the end of 42, and which decided the final solution. And the final solution was not just a decision. It was a decision with structured implementation. He gave an order that the best soldiers, all the trains, the best equipment should be devoted to the final solution, to create the gas chambers, to create the camps, and liquidate the ghettos, to bring the Jews and to annihilate them. And this was, therefore, this was a unique, which is never has a parallel in the history of mankind. Every Jew, if he is a Jew, he was recognized as a Jew. His destiny, if Hitler would have won the war, would have been killed. This was the policy, this was the philosophy, and he really wanted to implement. The fact is, when the generals on the Eastern Front told them that taking away the trains, taking away the best equipment, taking away soldiers to find a solution is weakening our front, he didn't care. He said, this is a priority. This has to be done, annihilation, the final solution. Therefore, the Holocaust is a nuke, and therefore I say, if somebody wants to say that the Holocaust is to generalize, and to make a parallel what Stalin did in the camps or what somebody else did before, so that this cannot be compared. Nor, I would say, even with all the stories, with all the best memories of the survivors, no one can really describe the truth in enough what happened. It will always remain unsaid and untold what happened. Only if God, something would happen, a miracle, when the 6 million, those who are perished, who are in Auschwitz, Treblinka, Belzec, and in other camps, which were, if they could speak, then they would tell the real story of what happened during World War II to the Jewish people. Besides of that, nobody else, that the survivors, do a lot, can tell a lot, but not enough. So we cannot remember, we cannot describe the horrible thing what happened to the Jewish people. Therefore, to tell to the survivors that we should forget and forgive, the survivors can never forget, they should not forget and should not forgive. I remember when I was on the Dead March, when I was on the in the camp, and I was sleeping at night, next somebody, strangers became friends. And all of a sudden somebody was already the last was dying. What was his message? Remember me. Remember me and tell the story. Tell the people the story. And when I said before in my first part or second part that Himmler in 1942 said that they should bring as a secret that they should not tell what they did, we are in a race with those of Himmler's, those of the Nazis, those of the deniers of the Holocaust, who they want to deny what happened. And with our memory, we have to fight back and to tell the people, to tell the world what happened. And therefore, it is so important what Spielberg is doing now, that he is interviewing the survivors and the bringing back the memories of them. I would never be able to remember and to prepare myself to remember all the things what happened, what I said today. But since I prepared myself, I made an effort to remember. But do I remember everything? No, I don't remember. Did I express the really feeling what happened? No, not enough. But I say that the Germans cannot expect from the survivors to forgive and forget.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is a continuation of tape 4. Mr. Sultanic, do you feel the Holocaust or something like it could happen again?
Nobody can guarantee that it will not happen. I hope it will never happen. I hope the warning of the survivors and the book which were written, and people like Elie Wiesel and others who are telling the story of what happened will warn, and also that we were in a way successful in making clear to the world that the story what we are telling is true and not the deniers of the Holocaust and not of the Nazis that was, which remain, which want to follow the philosophy of Hitler. And therefore, I believe it will never happen again. But nobody can guarantee. We have to be always aware that that things can happen not exactly in the same manner, in the same way, because circumstances are different, but it can always happen. Therefore, I was very enraged. For example, whenever it comes a moment when somebody wants in a way to deny or to make end the period of the Holocaust and forget about it, instead another one and begin another one, I am always revolting against that. And this happened to me when I was a member of the Holocaust Council in Washington, nominated by President Carter, and I will show you the letter and the pictures with Carter when I was nominated. And as a member of the Holocaust Council, Elie Wiesel was the chairman. And when President Reagan, decided to go to visit Bitburg, and when we found out that in Bitburg are buried Nazis, and we warned, and Elie Wiesel warned Reagan not to go, and he said, "Your place is not with the murderers. Your place are with the victims." And he told him not to go, but he went because it was a political thing. I said at the meeting of the Holocaust Council to Elie Wiesel, Elie Wiesel suggested that the Holocaust Council should send the resignation to Reagan if he goes to Bitburg. I said to Elie, this is not a way of answering this question. We should remain in the council, I said to him, and fight in the council with more authority against Reagan. Because I, as a member of the United States Holocaust Council appointed by the president, has more power to fight Reagan than I would be a Kaumis Sultanic, just a survivor. And it was a vote taken, and I think the great, great majority, two voted, the rest voted against resignation. But I said at this meeting, if Reagan will go to Bitburg, I am not a man who goes on demonstrations or protests. I will go to Bergen-Belsen and to Bitburg and to demonstrate against Reagan, against my president. Even even he is a very popular president. And in some way, to Israel, he's a very positive man. But nevertheless, this is such, and this enraged me so much, this angered me so much, this saddened me so much, that I could not take it that he, the president of the United States, should add to this in a way of identifying himself with the Nazis. I am sure, and I will explain to you later, or I can explain to you now, after when he was out of office, I have written to him letters, and I explained to him why I went to demonstrate against him, and explained to him. And he answered me with handwritten letters, writing to me, telling me that he was informed by the Germans that there are no Nazis buried in Bitburg, but this was not true. It was known to everyone that in Bitburg were Nazis. And then he said, he added to his program to go to Bergen-Belsen to visit. I told him that I am going to demonstrate. And I went to Bergen-Belsen to demonstrate, organize a demonstration against him in Bergen-Belsen. And I said that in Bergen-Belsen, you might have Germans, you might have and whoever you want, but it will be Juden rein, Juden frei. A Jew will not go to accompany you. He invited the Jewish community of Germany. I went there and convinced them that they shouldn't go. They didn't go with him. He went alone. And the New York Times interviewed me. It was published in the New York Times. And I have pictures in Bitburg demonstrating against him. And he and the letters, as I can see from his letters, that he, it was a political, he needed Germany. Kohl wanted to bring Reagan to make a demonstration that the past is the past, and he start in Germany, it's a new Germany, and he's starting a new beginning in Germany. And I didn't want to let it happen, and I did whatever and expressed by the demonstration against him. He, in the letters, in a way, he never accepted that he made a mistake. Nevertheless, he is trying to be ambivalent in connection with his going to Bitburg. And I'm very, very proud of me, myself, that I organized and had the courage to go to Bitburg. I remember when I was in Israel going before Bitburg to Bergen-Belsen to demonstrate, I was interviewed by a New York Times representative in Israel. And it was a German Jew. I have the interview with me, and I don't remember the name. I think Mann, Mr. M. From New York Times, and he said to me, you have to be very careful. The Germans are the same. You are going to demonstrate against in Bergen-Belsen. There will be Germans there. Don't be very careful. I said, what could they do me? They are not going to kill me. There's not a time of killing. We went, and I went, and I went to Hanover, met with the Jewish community. We organized a group, and we went to demonstrate against him in Bitburg. I'm glad that I did it. So another incident occurred. I later became very much involved with the conservation and preservation of Auschwitz because I believe that the survivors will live another 10 years, another 15 years, but there will be no survivors anymore. And Auschwitz doesn't represent only the 1.5 million Jews killed in the crematoriums in Auschwitz, but Auschwitz today represents the whole 6 million, because Auschwitz, I believe, is a graveyard without it is a cemetery without graves, and all of Auschwitz is covered with ashes. When I heard in the newspapers, and I was very active in the Auschwitz Museum, I was nominated by the Polish government to the Auschwitz Museum Council, and I was heard that Spielberg wants to film Schindler's List in Auschwitz. I wrote a letter to Spielberg and sent a copy to the New York Times. The New York Times published the letter, and I objected that he should film this for the reason what I explained before. Auschwitz is a cemetery without graves, and all of Auschwitz is full of ashes. That he cannot bring in Auschwitz 1,000 people with dogs to film Schindler's List. He has to find a way not to film on the premises of Auschwitz. He was very much mad. In the beginning, he objected to me. And he sent people to me to talk to me. I said, I will fight you. He said, I have a contact from the Polish government. I went to the Prime Minister of Poland, and I convinced the Prime Minister of Poland that they should take back their promise and revoke their agreement with Spielberg and not let him film. But he saw, and also after my letter was published in the New York Times to Spielberg, many letters were written to friends. Among them was Ernie Michel wrote a letter to him, and hundreds of other survivors that Kaumis Sultanik is right. You have no right, you have no weight, you should film it in on the premises of Auschwitz. Finally, after telephone calls here and there, we arranged a meeting in New York, a lunch meeting. He came with his assistant, and I came with the Secretary General of the World Jewish Congress, and we met at the West Side in a restaurant, I don't remember, for 2 hours, and I again made this point, convincing him that this is a sacred place, we cannot bring in this is impossible to do, and I will protest against it. And that he was thinking, and he asked his assistant, come, let us interrupt for a few minutes. I'm going with my assistant to consult. I will come back in a few minutes. Even there, we were sitting with Ilan Steinberg, and he came back in 5-10 minutes. He said, he brought a plan, he said, come.